Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. In this episode, astronomers using ESO's HARPS instrument find a new Earth-sized exoplanet around an inactive dwarf star known as Ross 128, and a new landmark five-year study released this week reveals that outdoor LED light fixtures are having an adverse effect on our night skies, and a new model of the universe is revealed that doesn't need dark matter nor dark energy. A team of astronomers working with ESO's High Accuracy Radial Velocity Planet Searcher, or HARPS, at the La Silla Observatory in Chile have found that the red dwarf star known as Ross 128 has a low-mass exoplanet that orbits once every 9.9 days. Now, because of its close proximity to the star, this Earth-sized world is expected to be temperate, with a surface temperature that may be close to that of Earth. Ross 128 is the quietest nearby star to host such a temperate exoplanet. Now, we've often talked about how great finding exoplanets around red dwarf stars is because these stars are so plentiful, they're so cool, and they live for trillions of years. And because of these characteristics, among others, astronomers assume that this would give life a maximum chance at starting and thriving, especially if the exoplanet is close enough to the red dwarf such that liquid water could exist. But there's a downside. Red dwarf stars early in their lives are quite active, throwing off enough radiation in the form of stellar storms and outbursts that could wreak havoc on any life that's trying to form there. So these stars are so active, and an exoplanet with liquid water would be close enough to it that they could even blow off the entire atmosphere of that the planet may have. Now, these high activity levels last for the first few billion years of the life of a red dwarf, but luckily they live for trillions of years. So if life can hold on long enough to get through that temper tantrum phase of the early life red dwarf, or if things like atmospheres and liquid water started forming after it was over, then things get pretty rosy looking for the possibility of life. Well, in this press release, ESO has said that Ross 128 is one of the quietest red dwarfs they've seen, making Ross 128 be pretty temperate. They don't know if there's any atmosphere yet, much less any liquid water. I mean, it may not even be in the habitable zone. They just don't know yet. So we need more observations, but this looks really promising. And here's what we do know from the HARPS observations. The team found that Ross 128b orbits 20 times closer than the Earth orbits the Sun. Yet despite this proximity, Ross 128b receives only 1.38 times more radiation than the Earth does. So it is closer, but doesn't receive all that much more radiation. As a result, Ross 128b, 128b's equilibrium temperature is estimated to lie between minus 60 and 20 degrees C, thanks to the cool and faint nature of its small red dwarf host star, which has a surface temperature of over just half of that of the Sun. Now, by comparison, the closest exoplanet to us, Proxima b, is orbiting a really active red dwarf, and it is subject to flares that occasionally bathe the planet in deadly ultraviolet and X-ray radiation. However, it seems that Ross 128 is a much quieter star, and so its planets may be the closest possible comfortable abode for possible life. Comfortable abode for possible life. That's a tough sentence. Now, here's an interesting factoid. Because of the eccentricity of its orbit in the galaxy, Ross 128 is moving towards us. Right now, it is 11 light years away, but in a mere 79,000 years from now, it is expected to become our nearest stellar neighbor. At that time, Ross 128b will by then be closer to us than Proxima Centauri b and become the closest exoplanet to the Earth. Next, most of us are now saving energy by purchasing and installing LED lights in and around our houses and enjoying the energy savings they bring. Cities and towns around the world have been doing the same thing by replacing high-energy mercury and sodium vapor streetlights with more efficient and bluer LED streetlights. Now, while LEDs are great in that they save energy, they have a distinct disadvantage as compared to sodium vapor lights. Those are those yellowish streetlights that you can still see all over the place. In that they can't be easily filtered out by astronomical telescopes. The wavelengths are too blue. This makes the installation of proper LED fixtures very important. They need to point straight down at the ground, using something called a full cutoff light fixture that prevents a lot of the light from going up into the sky, where it's basically useless. Well, a 5-year study released this week has shown that what appears to be happening is that instead of using the energy savings by just replacing the same level of mercury and sodium vapor lighting with LEDs, municipalities around the world are just using those savings to buy and install more lights. Now, why is this important and why is that a bad thing? Outdoor lighting accounts for a significant fraction of the nighttime energy budget of the typical world city, and anyone who's seen this image from NASA of the nighttime sky, or anyone who's just tried to see the Big Dipper for that matter, can attest to our disappearing dark skies. And I remember being astonished and a little bit grateful this past September when Hurricane Irma came through Florida and knocked out most of the power in the state. And I looked up and could see the Milky Way galaxy in a way I have only seen from the darkest skies in the desert Southwest. It was breathtaking. I mean, the difference was profound. And while you may not think about it much, losing our dark skies has important health and well-being implications for humans, not to mention the effects it has on wildlife. Now, compared to some of the other things facing humanity, like climate change, loss of natural resources, overpopulation, shrinking water supplies, and all that, this is a problem that we can solve relatively easily. Basically, you just want to be careful what kind of light fixtures you install. Make sure it's pointing down at the ground where you need the light, not spilling out to the sides or up into the sky. And also, don't install more than you need. Have you ever driven by a car dealership at night? You can see those things from space. I mean, why is all this light there? And why is it shining all the way up into the sky and out into the sides? And many gas stations are just as bad as well, or petrol stations. And, well, many insurance companies know there's a limited correlation between the amount of light installed in a property and the theft or the crime rate of that property. Now, if light does in fact stop crime, which many debate, then use the minimum amount you need to get the job done. You don't need to show the International Space Station where you are. Now, if you want to learn more about this problem, as well as the in-depth information on health effects and wildlife effects, as well as how you can help make things better, I encourage you to check out the International Dark Sky Association. The link is in the description box. Read their materials, and if you can, contribute financially to their efforts. They are our main defense and tool for protecting our dark skies, and hopefully getting more of it back. Now finally, remember a couple of episodes ago, I told you about the neutron star merger detected by the LIGO and Virgo instruments that also had an accompanying short gamma ray burst that was seen by the Fermi Space Telescope? And remember I said that the fact that the gravitational waves hit the detector 1.7 seconds before Fermi saw the short GRB? I told you then that the fact that these two events, the gravitational waves and the electromagnetic waves from the gamma ray burst, arriving at virtually the same time after traveling for hundreds of millions of years, was a good indication that gravitational waves traveled at the speed of light. And this observation also threw some cold water on the idea of MOND, the modified theory of Newtonian dynamics, which required a change in the way that we describe gravitational forces at large scales. And this is something many astronomers were reluctant to do because it screwed up other things they thought they knew about the universe. And, well, a great many, I'm sure, were relieved by what they saw in the neutron star merger event. Well, this week, it was announced by a University of Geneva researcher that he may have a model for the universe that doesn't need dark matter and dark energy. And, well, it also modifies Newtonian dynamics a little bit, too. Now, I'm going to try to get this guy in a deep astronomy hangout so we can learn more, but from what little I've gathered from the press release, his model departs from the general theory of relativity, of which Newtonian dynamics is a specific instance of relativity's equations, by assuming that empty space is invariant, meaning it doesn't change over time. In general relativity, empty space plays an important role in Einstein's equations as it operates in something known as a cosmological constant, and the resulting universal model depends on it. This is the term that most dark energy researchers are trying to find out if it is in fact a constant or not, and it also helps describe the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. So, this researcher, Dr. Andre Mader, carried out cosmological tests on his new model, and he found that it matched observations. He also found that the model predicts the accelerated expansion of the universe without having to factor in any particle or dark energy. In short, it appears that dark energy may not actually exist, according to this, since the acceleration of the expansion is contained in the equations of the physics. And in a second stage test, Mader focused on Newton's law. It is also slightly modified when the model incorporates Mader's new hypothesis. Indeed, it contains a very small outward acceleration term, which is particularly significant at low densities. This amended law, or, well, MOND, when applied to clusters of galaxies, leads to masses of clusters that are in line with that of visible matter only. This means that no dark matter is needed to explain the high speeds in the galaxies of the galaxies in the clusters. So, where does this leave us? It's, well, not necessarily back where we started, because the neutron star merger was quite powerful observational evidence, and while I don't think it refutes the model by Mader, his model does raise some interesting questions. And as I said, I want to get this guy on a hangout and try to learn more about the specifics of the model, because unfortunately I just don't know them right now. Science's ability to describe the universe is only as strong as the assumptions it starts with, and Mader is challenging a key assumption of Einstein, that of empty space being invariant. Sometimes, going back to the beginning and looking at where we started is a vital component to ensuring that our knowledge of the universe is as accurate as we can make it. And I promise I will keep you posted. Well, that is it for this episode, space fans. Next week, I'll be at the SETI Institute attending a Planets Foundation workshop, and I'll try to do some live streaming while I'm there. And I want to acknowledge Deep Astronomy Patreon patrons who helped make SFN possible. I also want to give a special thanks to these guys whose contributions over the last year have been tremendous. Thank you all so much. All right, well, thanks to all of you for watching. And as always, keep looking.